to historian Henri Sterlin, the bust of Nefertiti is simply too well preserved, or, as he puts it, too new to be true. Then there is a second bust found lying alongside that of Nefertiti. It's a bust of her husband, the pharaoh Akhenaton, and it's completely disfigured. Why should there be such a difference in the condition of the busts, which were found at the same time, at the same place? So is Nefertiti a fake? In Montpellier, in southern France, archaeologist and Egyptologist Marc Gabold, who is also an expert on Nefertiti, considers Sterlin's claims.
I have to say he was right to ask the question,
but the arguments he's provided aren't necessarily sufficient. If he can give me some strong scientific arguments that it is a forgery, then I would accept it. There's certainly some doubts. In the basements of the Neues Museum in Berlin, a news conference is being held. The journalists are taking notes, but there are no questions about the charges of authenticity. In Germany, such accusations are considered taboo, because the bust, discovered a century ago in Egypt by German archaeologist Ludwig Borchardt, has now become a symbol in Germany. Nevertheless, we did ask the question to Neues Museum director Frederike Seyfried. When you stand before the bust, the question never even enters your mind. It goes without saying it's authentic. The real question is, why would it be a fake? Numerous archaeologists, Americans, Italians, French, have expressed their doubts about whether the bust is genuine, but none of them have made their doubts official. So we've decided to stage our own inquiry.
You see, everyone's being very circumspect.
No one has dared come right out and openly declare the object to be a fake. So is the most famous bust of ancient Egypt a phony? To find out, we met with the greatest experts, subjected the bust to a lie detector, and retraced history. What we uncovered during our inquiry will forever change your opinion about Egypt's most mysterious queen and her likeness, the bust of Nefertiti. Nefertiti was the principal wife of Akhenaton. She was the only one who had the rights to the title Great Spouse of the King. We know the Queen's sisters, and we know of her nurse. But we know nothing about the origins of Nefertiti's family. To be honest, I'd have to say we don't know. She's the Queen of Egypt, of whom we have the most representations and documents, but also the one of whom we know the least. It's not known who Nefertiti's parents were, but what's striking is her remarkable beauty, with a face that at first appears so contemporary. It's thanks to her husband, Akhenaton, the heretic and rebel, that her name has survived. The pharaoh has gone down in history for having imposed Aton, the sun god, as the only deity, and getting rid of the rest of the many Egyptian gods. During his reign in the 18th dynasty, Akhenaton has new temples built, many of them open to the skies, to allow the sun's beneficial rays to shine through. In his new religion, Akhenaton develops a cult of the personality, as he and the sun god gradually become the same being. Nefertiti and Akhenaton were also the most romantic of all the pharaonic couples. Their love for each other began at a very young age. On these statuaries, their age is given as 14. For the first time, the people witness two adolescents, masters of an empire, holding hands.
They are portrayed
as being very much in love.
All the
more astonishing are the images of the king and queen embracing.
They are
depicted on the royal chariot. Akhenaton is kissing Nefertiti. The queen is shown placing a necklace around the king's neck, and he seizes the moment to give her a peck on the cheek. It's a very intimate moment and must reflect a true love story. In the seventh year of their reign, Akhenaton and Nefertiti relocate from Karnak and set up at Tel el Amarna in the middle of the desert. There they build a new royal city they call Akhet Aton, which means the sun's horizon. The most famous couple in the history of Egypt lived in a modern city that was built quickly with space for 50,000 inhabitants. A city dotted with temples that had no roofs. Akhenaten and Nefertiti spend much of their time worshipping the sun god. But the reign of Akhenaten and Nefertiti will last only 17 years. After their deaths, their successors will destroy all trace of their existence and dismantle the palaces brick by brick. In less than 30 years, the city will disappear back into the desert.
You might say it's the Pompeii of the sands.
When you dig through the buildings from the 18th dynasty, the only time they were occupied was during the era of Akhenaten, so just over 15 years. And it gives one a real snapshot of life in Egypt back then.
On a un instantané de la vie égyptienne.
It was in this 5 by 10 kilometer rectangle of desert that on the 6th of December 1912, the bust of Nefertiti emerged whole from the middle of nowhere. Ludwig Borchardt was born in Berlin in 1863. He became the most famous archaeologist of his day. Egypt, its monuments and architecture fascinated Borchardt. In 1906, the German archaeologist organizes a dig in the remains of Akhenaten's city. A ghost town, according to some, but the site of a terrible act of vandalism to the archaeologists. Borchardt is a real sleuth and is persuaded he'll make the discovery of the century. And on the 6th of December 1912, surrounded by his team, he will uncover the find of a lifetime, the celebrated bust of Nefertiti. The statuette, carved from limestone, was found just 50 centimeters below some gravel. Borchardt has resurrected a remarkably lifelike and technicolor queen. But how did archaeologist Borchardt make this masterpiece appear out of nowhere? Before the arrival of the German, Akhenaten's ancient city had been the virtual preserve of the British and their chief archaeologist, Sir Flinders Petrie, who had led major excavations on the site in 1891 and 1892. They had opened tombs, unearthed the magnificent frescoes of senior officials, and uncovered the foundations of palaces. But they had never come across anything like the magnificent bust of Nefertiti. So when Borchardt's archaeological expedition showed up, it made the British sneer. They're convinced the German will find absolutely nothing.
Flinders Petrie was already there. He stopped, I think, at the end of the 19th century working in Tell el Amarna, and for him, he was through. He had the idea, it is done, and nobody has to... There's nothing to find anymore. But, I mean, as we know, this was not true.
Borchardt, he came to Amarna initially because he saw it as a major source of information on domestic architecture. But at the back of his mind was the fact that he had close connections with the Berlin Museum, and he rather wanted something spectacular to bring back to Berlin.
In 1906, the German archaeologist organizes a dig in the remains of Akhenaten's city. A ghost town, according to some, but the site of a terrible act of vandalism to the archaeologists. Borchardt is a real sleuth and is persuaded he'll make the discovery of the century. And on the 6th of December 1912, surrounded by his team, he will uncover the find of a lifetime, the celebrated bust of Nefertiti. The statuette, carved from limestone, was found just 50 centimeters below some gravel. Borchardt has resurrected a remarkably lifelike and technicolor queen. But how did archaeologist Borchardt make this masterpiece appear out of nowhere? Before the arrival of the German, Akhenaten's ancient city had been the virtual preserve of the British and their chief archaeologist, Sir Flinders Petrie, who had led major excavations on the site in 1891 and 1892. They had opened tombs, unearthed the magnificent frescoes of senior officials, and uncovered the foundations of palaces. But they had never come across anything like the magnificent bust of Nefertiti.
So when Borchardt's archaeological expedition showed up, it made the British sneer.